Start. So the last thing that I left the Anatom. Oh god, disaster. Total disaster. Scrivo lì sopra. No, this is a special pen. Is it a special pen for because it's è qua, c'è il suo apposito slot. Sorry, there is a problem. I left a special pen for writing on the laptop at home. Eh no, è proprio un'altra. Col dito, però, col dito fa, credo che... Let me just try one thing, but I doubt that it's going to work. I think I can write with a finger, but it's really horrible. It cannot... Ah, sorry. Okay. So I will have to write on a piece of paper today. Sorry. Today is a disaster. Sorry. Sì, infatti userò quella, solo che... sì, ok. I can anyway show you something on the laptop, I think, and I can write also there. Ah! Sorry. Quindi devo ricollegare quella di Giulia, giusto? Ok. E questo qua bisogna ricollegare anche lui, però. Ok. Allora, calma e gesso. Andiamo di fare questa operazione. Allora. Ah, questo qui. Qua dentro. Poi. Grazie. Dunque, aspetta, questo qua. Un po' di foglie. Questo qui dove era già qua? Ecco.
Prima vediamo il proiettore, era già attaccato.
Ok. Aspetta, vediamo se riesce. Fa qualcosa? Sì, sta facendo già qualcosa. Ok. Accidenti, l'ho usato evidentemente a casa e mi è rimessa dentro. Maledizione. Ok. E questo è quello che scrive qua sopra, giusto?
Esatto.
Ok, va bene. Allora ce la facciamo. Però devo ricollegarmi qua e qui, chissà dov'è qua il. Vediamo un attimo, e questo qua o l'altro, questo sarà chissà quale dei due, Firefox o questo qua che è
oddio, io di solito uso Chrome, però
Chrome qua non lo vedo, però
penso vada bene anche con Firefox.
Però e qui però bisogna trovare un attimo qual era la pagina. La pagina è questa pagina qua, Meet Google. Oh, signor.
Sì. Andare tipo dal sito.
Ah, devo passarci da lì, devo passarci. Ok. Aspetta. Sarà salvata sta pagina, dite? Sì, sarà salvata. Il servizio online era forse.
Forse c'è sul desktop.
Sul desktop dici? Aspetta. Chiudiamo anche questo.
Eccolo.
Dov'è?
Questo
qua dici, eccolo.
Sì.
E lì però vediamo se. È lentissimo proprio questo aggeggio.
Sì.
Vediamo che ci sia la pagina già.
Già salvata.
Non si vede niente adesso. Ah, ma prima non si vedeva qualcosa, prima no. Ah, niente, oh signore, allora bisogna riavviarlo. Ah, no, si è scollegato qua, sta Gigio qua. Aspetta. Questo qui che si è brutalmente scollegato. Ok, adesso forse magari proprio.
Sì, l'ho proprio attaccato bene. Qua sta iniziando, eccolo.
Sto andando.
Sì, vedersi se hai visto, poi se.
No, non, esatto, non riesco mica da. Ma si riesce ad evitare sto Gigio magnetico. Si evita così, non avrebbe.
No, non so. Vabbè, intanto comunque si sta fermo.
Teniamolo lì fermo. Esatto, allora, adesso qui bisogna ancora trovare sta pagina. Ecco, forse che sia questo qui, il Meet. Qui c'è un Meet. Sì. Allora, adesso devo però ricordarmi. Allora, questo qui deve essere il mio nome su Unife, che deve essere di RGLSN. Aspettami, sono un po' pulente. Bookmarks.
Non ho capito, ragazzi, secondo voi stava cercando di inserire tra i segnalibri questa pagina?
Io non sto capendo, segue basta. La considero parte della lezione.
Prof, scusi, deve attivare il microfono.
Ok. Ok, everything is fine now.
C'è un ritorno della voce da qualche parte.
Ecco, adesso l'ho tolto perché c'era... Is okay now? Do you hear me fine?
Ora va bene.
Ok, va bene, grazie. Ok. Okay. So, to go back here. Gosh. And so, Neumann boundary conditions, meaning that, okay, we have some initial value and the u over the x for x equal to zero and every time we put it equal to zero, and similarly the u over the x for x equal to l we put equal to zero. So this is the problem that we have been discussing. And we have solved the problem. You recall that this problem is different respect to the problem with the Dirichlet boundary conditions, essentially because it admits a solution which is space independent, meaning that if I add to my solution a constant, essentially, what happens is that the left-hand side of my equation, of course, is not changing. And the point is that also these boundary conditions are satisfied if u is a constant. Okay. So, this means that there is, if we consider this differential operator here, with the Neumann boundary conditions, there is also the eigenvalue equal to zero that we have to take into account. And that's why we have essentially separated the Fourier decomposition into the subproblem corresponding to eigenvalue equal to zero and all the other eigenvalues. So to just to write down probably the last formula that we wrote last time, we ended up with something like this. So we expand on a basis which is the basis of the cosinus plus a constant, that is the basis. We expand everything on that basis. And in particular, we expand our solution. So we expand u of x and t as b0t plus sum on n from 1 to infinity of bn t cosinus of n pi x divided by l, and we have therefore this time dependent coefficients, and we have shown that the time dependent coefficients satisfy ordinary differential equations, and in particular for this problem. For this problem, if we take f equal to zero, if f is equal to zero, then the problem simplifies and becomes rho c d b zero over dt equal to zero and rho c d b n over dt plus k n square pi square divided by l square bn equal to zero, and this is, this of course corresponds to the eigenvalue which is zero, and this corresponds to the cases n equal to 1, 2, etc. And the initial values for this set of differential equations are obtained, of course, by expanding also the psi of x on the same basis. So we expand psi of x as, let's say, d0 plus sum from 1 to infinity of dn cosinus of n pi x over l. And of course, we can easily compute these numbers. And just let me remind you that there is a different normalization for the eigenvalues with n different from zero, n equal 1, 2, etc., so the cosinus, respect to the so for eigenfunctions with n equal 1, 2, respect to the eigenfunction with n equal to 0, because the one with n equal to 0 is a constant, and the normalization, it involves the integral from 0 to L of a constant, which is the constant times L. While for all the other eigenfunctions, the normalization is L divided by 2, because as you recall, the trigonometric function sinus cosinus squared, when evaluated on a finite number of semicycles, they average to 1/2. Okay, so essentially this is all what we need, because the initial conditions are obtained by expanding psi in this way. So the initial conditions correspond to writing something as b0 of 0 equal to d0, and similarly for the other ones. So similarly we have bn, similarly we have the bn which corresponds to the dn bn of 0 equal to dn. So at that point we have completely defined our set of differential equations, which are the solution of the problem using the Fourier decomposition, and that's it. So what I want to do now is to discuss with you a specific problem that one faces when studying stationary problems with Neumann boundary conditions. The problem that we are going to discuss is a problem of, so to say, existence and unicity of the solution. What I mean is we are going to discuss if the problem of finding time-independent solutions, steady-state solutions, is well-defined with Neumann boundary conditions. And let's start by some physical argument, so to say. So if we go back to the question that we were discussing, so we are looking for solving the time-independent problem. So let me just rewrite a moment explicitly. The problem we want to solve is minus k second derivative of u respect to x squared equal to f of x. Okay, I wrote f of x because it is quite clear that if f depends on time, then I cannot hope to find U, which is time independent. And this we want to solve together with the Neumann boundary conditions. So this evaluated at x equal to zero, and similarly evaluated at x equal to f. Okay. So why there can be, so to say, a problem? So we have here, first of all, decided that f cannot depend on time. Now, f, as you recall, if we discuss the problem of heat diffusion, corresponds to having some source of heat or some sink of heat. So essentially areas where heat is either deposited or withdrawn from the system. But we are interested in finding a time independent solution. So that means that if in a certain area I am depositing some heat, then that heat must be removed from another area. Because instead, if there is an imbalance, if globally I am either depositing more heat than what I am withdrawing, or vice versa, it is clear that the temperature will just keep increasing or decreasing, and I will never reach a steady state. There is no steady state. So what does this mean in conclusion? We can anticipate that this means essentially that if I integrate from zero to L, so on all the system, my f of x, this must be equal to zero. We will find this relation in a much more formal way, but it is intuitively clear. This just means that globally, the f of x, that as I said, corresponds to depositing or removing it, must average to zero. So if f of x does not average to zero, then I can already conclude that this problem here has no solution. There is no solution to this problem because this corresponds to a situation in which I am just depositing more and more heat or removing more and more heat, and there is no solution. Supposing now that this condition is satisfied, so suppose that this source or sink of heat, they average to zero. So the next question is there a unique solution or not? So recall, we are using Neumann boundary conditions. So Neumann boundary conditions correspond to the situation in which this, for instance, is a bar. The bar is insulated at the two extremes. So there is no flow of heat entering or leaving at the two extremes. And moreover, we have just imposed this condition that tells us that, okay, there can be inside the bar a certain region where it is produced, but that it is then removed from another part of the bar. So what I can intuitively understand is that since U, the quantity that I want to determine, is the temperature, then most likely the solution is not unique. Because if I have reached an equilibrium, okay, it just means that I am not changing the temperature. But there is nothing in these equations that is telling us which is the temperature. These equations are just essentially telling that there is no heat entering from one side, leaving from the other side, and there is no deposition, no net deposition of heat inside the bar. But there is essentially nothing in these equations that is telling us which is really the temperature. If I get a solution, I can get another solution just by shifting all the temperatures by the same amount. Okay, this is intuitively maybe clear, but we are going to discuss this now in details. So let's see how to obtain this same results. So what I want to start with is to clarify this condition here, from where it comes. So suppose that we start from our equation, this equation here, and suppose that we integrate this equation. So let's integrate from 0 to L the x f of x. Therefore, if we have solved this equation, if we have obtained a U satisfying that equation and the boundary conditions, then this means that this is equal to minus k, the integral from 0 and L, dx, second derivative of U over x squared. But of course, this can be integrated, and this just gives minus k, and here I have exactly the U over dx evaluated at 0, evaluated at L, but because of the Neumann boundary conditions, this is equal to 0. So we see that this condition immediately needs to be imposed. I mean, mathematically, we see that if we got a solution to the equation, then this implies that the integral on all the bar, on all the system of f of x must be equal to 0. And also the other obvious point is, suppose that we found a solution, therefore this condition is satisfied. Is the solution unique? And immediately we can check that it's not true, because suppose that we found a solution U of x, what happens if I consider a V of x, which is equal to U of x plus a constant C? It is clear that it's still a solution, because this constant C does not change the left-hand side, because of course it's annihilated by the second derivative, and actually does not change the boundary conditions, because again, since it is constant, trivially satisfies the boundary conditions. So this means immediately that if we have found a solution, the solution is not unique. On the other hand, if f does not average to 0, there is no solution. So either there is no solution, or there is an infinite number of solutions. And let me discuss this point still in another way, by discussing through the Fourier decomposition. So if we do through a Fourier decomposition, let me write again the same expansion as we did before. So we have U of x equal to B0 plus a sum on n from 1 to infinity Bn cosinus of n pi x over. So we know how to determine these coefficients by substituting, of course, into the equation. And if we substitute into the equation, what we get is, okay, minus k second derivative of u respect to x squared. And of course, b0 does not appear. So this means that what we get is just the sum from 1 to infinity of bn, and what we get is again the constant k, and after we know that what appears are the eigenvalues, So what we get is n square pi square divided by r square, and again the cosinus of n pi x divided by l. So suppose that we expand our solution in this Fourier basis. The Fourier basis contains B0. Okay, so how do we determine B0, B1, B2, Bn? Take the expansion, we substitute into the equation, we evaluate the left-hand side, that is written here, but on the left-hand side, B0 does not appear. And now, what about the right-hand side? Well, the right-hand side is f of x. And f of x, as usual, we expand writing c0 plus a sum 1 to infinity of cn cosinus of n pi x over l. So what happens is that for all the coefficients with n different from zero, we get a usual result. I mean, what we get is that the left-hand side must be equal to the right-hand side, and therefore, essentially, we have to equate the Cn and this quantity that is written here. So the relation that we are getting is for n different from zero is, let's say, Bn, which is what we want to determine, Bn is equal to, okay, from this relation, is L square Cn divided by K n square pi square. But what about B0? The point is that when we equate the left-hand side and the right-hand side, on the left-hand side, there is not the equivalent of C0. So this means, or simply, that C0 must be equal to zero. But B0 is undetermined. But what is C0? C0 is the projection of f on the eigenfunctions corresponding to the zero eigenvalue, to the constant. So C0 is just the integral from zero to L dx of f of x, and if we like, we can put the normalization 1 over L, and we have just noticed that C0 must be equal to zero. And therefore, again, we get the fact that the integral from zero to L, the x f of x must be equal to zero. So also by doing the Fourier decomposition, we conclude that this C0, which is the integral of f of x, must average to zero, and B0 we cannot determine. So we can always add, of course, a solution to a solution of whatever constant, and is still a solution. Okay, do you have questions concerning this part here? Is okay?
Yes, it's okay, thank you.
Okay. Fine then. So what we have done up to now was to discuss how to solve the time-dependent equation of diffusion by using the Fourier decomposition. But as you recall, the central part of this course is, so to say, not related to the Fourier decomposition, but is related to general techniques, numerical techniques, that we can use when we are not really able to compute the eigenfunctions and eigenvalues of our time-independent differential operator. So now we switch to the other technique that we started discussing, which is the technique of finite elements. So we want to apply the technique of finite elements now to the problem of heat diffusion. So we have used the technique when studying the equation of Poisson. The equation of Poisson is essentially the time independent part of a problem that appears, for instance, in the equation of diffusion or in the equation of the waves. And we have seen essentially how it works. And let me rapidly repeat which are the building blocks of this finite element technique when we also have the time dependent piece of the equation, where we have derivative respect to time. So what you want to do is solve the equation of diffusion, including, of course, the time dependence. So the equation we are discussing is rho c, the u. Sì. Oh, grazie, sì, scusa. Grazie. Sorry. Rho c, the u over the t. Minus k second derivative of u over x square equal to f of x and t. And as usual, we have an initial value. So we have u of x and some t0 equal to psi of x. And let's go back to the Dirichlet boundary conditions. We will discuss the Neumann boundary conditions later on. So the Dirichlet boundary conditions are u x equal to zero, t equal to zero, and u x equal to t equal to zero. Okay. So this is our equation. And let me remind you, how do we obtain the technique of the finite elements? It is based essentially on three ideas. The three ideas are, first of all, we rewrite this problem, which is the strong version of the boundary value problem, into the weak version of the boundary value problem. And as you recall, what we do is essentially to take the equation, to multiply the equation by a sort of test function, to integrate, to perform one partial integration, and we get that sort of integral equation that is the weak version. So we multiply this equation by some test function, let's say v here, and here, and here. And as usual, we integrate. So what we get is something as integral from 0 to L dx rho c, the u over the t. And this depends on x and t. And we multiply by v of x. And okay, this after we perform one partial integration, but let me try for the moment just k second derivative of u v, and all this must be equal to the integral between zero and L dx of f of x and t v of x. So as usual, what happens is that we perform a partial integration on this piece here. And when we perform a partial integration, of course, we get a first derivative in u times v. And we recall that also v has to satisfy the same boundary conditions. So v of x equal to 0 is equal to v of x equal to l is equal to 0. And therefore, when we perform this partial integration, the integrated part, the part containing the u over the x v, is equal to 0, because v is evaluated at 0 and at l. And therefore, what remains is the following equation, is the integral 0 and l dx of rho c du over dt. And here we get v. And therefore, we change the sign, because we have performed the partial integration, plus k du over dx dv over dx. And this is again equal to the integral between 0 and l dx of f of x and t v of x. Okay, so what we have now in front of us is the first step. We have transformed our strong version of the problem into this weak version of the problem that tells that we are looking for a function u satisfying the Dirichlet boundary conditions, such that this integral relation is satisfied for whatever test function v of x. So we are looking for a u such that this equation, this last equation, is satisfied for whatever test function v of x, also satisfying the same boundary conditions. So this is the weak version. There are other two steps, as you recall. The next step is this idea of Galerkin. The idea of Galerkin is to say that it is possible to rewrite this equation. Instead of discussing functions which are living in an infinite dimensional space, L square, we restrict to a finite dimensional subspace. And the restriction of this equation into the finite dimensional subspace is properly done, in the sense that the equation that we are writing, the solution of the equation that we are writing, corresponds to the best approximation to the solution of the original equation if we restrict to that subspace. Okay. So, here we choose a certain basis, so the basis, let's say phi 1, phi 2, phi n minus 1. Recall that we use this notation because we will end up, of course, in a moment with special functions, which are the triangular functions, which are defined like this, etc. So, and this is L, of course, this is zero. And as you recall, this is the, okay, this is x1, this is x2, which is this one, x2, etc. This is xn minus 1. So L would be xn, and this is x0. And we don't need, with the Dirichlet boundary conditions, we don't need to introduce a function which is centered at zero on a function which is centered at L, because, of course, we are imposing homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions, so the solution is vanishing at zero and at L. And so, if we have made, for instance, that partition of the interval into n sub-intervals, the number of functions that we need is n minus 1. So that is why I have already introduced this notation, etc. So, this means that we can expand our solution, our U of X and T. Now this solution, let's put a label N just to recall that we are already working in the subspace which is spanned by these functions. Let's call this subspace, let's say Sn is the subspace spanned by these functions. And this U of N, Un of X and T, is therefore the sum on I from 1 to N minus 1 of coefficients which are time dependent, phi of X. So if you think back, you recognize that this is essentially the same that we did when solving the Poisson equation, it is time independent, but this time these coefficients are instead time dependent. So as usual, what we have to do is to find the ordinary differential equations which are regulating the time dependence of the coefficients. So, okay, to do that, let's just go again through these steps of the Kalerkin technique, already having in mind an expansion of this type of functions. So essentially what happens is, first of all, let me just rewrite the weak version of the problem, having restricted ourselves to this subspace. Essentially, it means that I am looking for a function U of N, so a function that belongs to this subspace, a function that satisfies the following equation, rho C, the un over the t, v, this is depends on x and t, while this depends only on x, plus k, and here I have derivative of un over the x, derivative of v over x, integrated dx, and this is equal to the integral between 0 and L dx f of x v of x. Okay, so this must be satisfied for whatever v. Okay, we are looking for a function u of n. The n here just indicates that I am restricting myself to a subspace which is the subspace, for instance, that I indicated above, spanned by those functions. So I am looking now for a function belonging to that subspace. This function has to satisfy this equation for whatever v also belonging to that subspace. And now you see which are the last two little ideas. First of all, u of n, we have already expanded here on this basis. And the second point is to claim that u of n has to satisfy this equation for whatever v belonging to the subspace can be reformulated by saying u of n has to satisfy this equation for each of the elements of the basis, phi 1, phi 2, phi n minus 1. Because of course, also v of x can be expanded on that basis. And the equation that we are looking at is linear in v of x. So if we expand v of x is whatever. And we know that it can be expanded on this basis, but since this equation is linear, it means that it's enough to demonstrate that u of n satisfies this equation for each of the elements of the basis. So essentially what we do is to take, instead of v of x, one of the phi I. This equation needs to be satisfied for each of the elements of the basis. and U of n is expanded as I already wrote. Therefore, we end up with the following equation. We end up, so we expand U of n as I wrote above. Okay, maybe let's call this expansion instead of summing on I, sum on j, so that I have two indexes, I and j. And I take I as the other index. Okay, so this means essentially that I get sum on j from 1 to n minus 1. And now what do I have here? I have the derivative of un respect to time. Time enters only through the coefficient. Therefore, I have a derivative of alpha j respect to time. And after, I have the integral between 0 and L of what? Of, so I'm concentrating on the first term, on rho c. Inside U of n, there is phi j, I'm summing to j, so here I have phi j. And I am taking as a test function phi I, with I running from 1 to n minus 1, phi I. So this is what I get from the first term of the weak form of the equation. Similarly, the second term contains a sum on j from 1 up to n minus 1. And here I don't have any time derivative, so alpha j just appears as alpha j. And what remains is the integral between 0 and L. This one, sorry, there was an integral dx that I missed. Here, of course, I have to integrate dx. Here, the same integrate dx. And again, what I am getting is, what I'm getting is derivative of phi j over the x, derivative of phi I over the x, and I was forgetting the k, let me put the k here. Okay. And finally, all this must be equal to the expansion of the right hand side, where instead of v, I put 1 over phi I, so the integral between 0 and f dx of f of x phi I of x. Okay. So this is our expansion. Okay. So let me just remind this, what we did is very simple. We started from the equation. We rewrote the equation in the weak form by multiplying by the test function, integrating and performing one partial integration. And after, we restrict ourselves to the subspace. And at that point, we expand everything on the subspace. We expand the solution. We expand f of x on the subspace. This we have not yet done, but we are going to do, of course. That is what is written here, essentially. The last equation is nothing but the expansion, actually. And also the test function can be expanded on that subspace. And since all what we are claiming is that the equation has to be satisfied for whatever test function, this is equivalent to saying the equation has to be satisfied for each of the elements of the basis of the subspace. And therefore, we end up with this set of equations. And what do we notice? If we know the problem, if we know the basis, so we have chosen our basis, we know rho, c, k, and whatever, it is clear that what remains is a set of coupled ordinary differential equations, equations in the time dependence of the coefficients. Okay. If now I give names to these various pieces, let for instance call M-I-J. M-I-J is what appears in the first term on the left-hand side. So this M-I-J is the integral between zero and L, dx of rho c phi I phi j of x, to be precise, phi j is the same, but okay. Phi j of x, phi I of x, and that's it. And that call k I j, the other object, which is the integral between zero and L, the x of k d phi j over the x d phi I over the x. And therefore, the equations that I just wrote can be rewritten in terms of these two objects. And okay, I can also introduce the f. Okay, is essentially just the same. So the f, let me put an arrow to indicate that it contains n minus one components, and these n minus one components, of course, are what? Are just integral between zero and L, dx of f phi one, integral between zero and L, dx of f phi n minus one. And finally, let me introduce also another vector, alpha, which is of course alpha 1, alpha n minus 1. Okay. So if you look back to those equations, you see that those equations can be rewritten as in the following form. We have a matrix M. And this matrix M acts onto a column, the column of the derivative of alpha respect to time. Okay, so the matrix is n minus one times n minus one matrix acting on this column, which is a length of n minus one, plus the other matrix K, acting directly on alpha, and this is equal to another vector, which is f. Okay. In principle, f can depend on time, in principle, because here this f can depend on x and time, etc. So this is our set of ordinary differential equations, and if we solve, we get the time evolution of the solution. How do we fix the initial condition, the initial values, using the usual trick? So you recall that the problem was set by saying that at time t equal to zero, it was u of x and zero, t zero, whatever, equal to psi of x, okay? And therefore, what we do is to expand both the u and the psi on the basis. So essentially what we write is something like this. Let's call it t zero instead of zero, maybe just to follow the notation of the book. So what we do is we can expand, of course, u of x and evaluate it at t zero. And from here, what we get is a sum on I from one up to n minus one of the coefficients evaluated at t zero and the elements of the basis. So this is what I do if I just evaluate my solution expanded on the elements of the basis at t equal to zero. But psi of x, which is known, I mean is one of the given things of the problem, can also be expanded in a similar way. And in particular, I approximate, so to say, this psi of x in the following way. I write it as a sum, again, from 1 up to n minus 1 of psi evaluated at xi, phi I of x. If you recall, we did essentially the same trick a few lessons ago when we introduced for the first time this basis of triangular functions. This psi of x, let's say that is approximated inside the basis in this way. What does it mean that is approximated? You recall, let me just write it here, that phi I of xj is a delta ij. All these triangular functions that are built, first of all, by discretizing the interval between 0 and L. After I build these triangular functions, and each of them evaluated on one of the nodes, okay, there is, for each node, there is only one of the functions which is different from 0 and is set equal to 1, and all the other are identically 0. Okay. So this means essentially that if I take psi and evaluate psi at a specific point xj, what happens is that let's check if it is consistent. What I get from the right hand side is a sum from 1 up to n minus 1 of psi of xi, but phi I of xj is delta ij, and so I get again psi of xj. So this relation, so to say, indicates that if I evaluate my approximation of the function psi on each of the points of the grid, each of the nodes, I get exactly the original function. So if you like, you can make a little drawing like this. The little drawing is that, suppose that you have your function psi of x, whatever it is, okay, and you made your grid, and now what we are doing is to build an approximation to this function, which is a psi of x. The approximation is linear, so it's like this. Okay, so essentially what we are saying is that we obtain our initial values, impose our initial values by approximating psi of x on the grid through a piecewise linear function belonging also to Sn, which is identical to psi of x on each of the points of the grid and linearly interpolates between them. Okay, so what remains to be discussed? We will start this now, but next time I think I will show you how to implement in the numerical code, is how to solve in concrete this equation. Because let me write once more this equation. So the equation that we have is again m, and here we have our d alpha over dt plus k alpha equal to some f of t. Okay. With initial condition, so we know that alpha of t0 is equal to something that we are able to determine, alpha 0. So how do we solve this problem? How do we solve this problem? Well, in principle, one is tempted to say we can decouple these equations by multiplying by the inverse of the matrix M. And of course, we can do that, and we get something like d alpha over dt equal to minus m minus 1 times k times alpha plus m minus 1 times f. Okay. So at this point, essentially, we have decoupled all the derivatives, okay? And this is one of the typical problems that we discussed several lessons ago. This is a set of linear ordinary differential equations, and we have written this equation in the canonical form, the alpha over the t. And of course, here we have a matrix and blah, blah, and blah, blah. This object here and this object here. If you like, you can write this as, let's say, another matrix A applied to alpha plus G. Okay, so the alpha over the T can be written, let's say, in this form. This is essentially what we are not going to do, okay? Why we are not going to do this manipulation? Why we are not going to multiply by m minus 1 and after to try to solve these equations? Essentially because, as you recall, the main reason to develop this finite element technique, and in particular to use a basis of triangular functions, is that it allows us to build matrices, these matrices M and K, which are not diagonal, but almost diagonal. Three diagonal, for instance, if we are considering those linear piecewise functions as elements of the basis. And which is the advantage? The main advantage is that we don't need, in order to solve a problem, we don't need to numerically compute the inverse of the matrix M, because that is an extremely time consuming problem. Okay. So what we are going to do now, I want to start showing you in concrete how we can use one of the codes that are inside Python, actually in one of these packages, that allows us to exploit the fact that the matrix is almost diagonal, is three diagonal. Okay, so let me summarize what we did. So we have seen that the problem of solving the equation of diffusion by using finite element technique can be rewritten at the very end as a set of coupled first order linear differential equations, and in principle we can solve these equations. We can, for instance, decouple all the first order derivatives, just multiplying by m minus 1, and therefore we get exactly one of the forms of equations that we discussed many lessons ago. Okay, fine. But we want now instead to understand how to exploit the fact that the matrix M in particular is almost diagonal. Is there a way in order to speed up the numerical solution of the problem? Is there a way to avoid the need of computing M to minus 1? Okay, before showing you some little implementation with Python, let me just make a little comment. Little comment is, it is quite clear that if we have some matrix which has a special form, and let's say we want to solve a problem AX equal to B, where A is a matrix, okay, and B is a vector, and we are looking for a vector X. If A has some special form, there are situations in which the solution of the problem can be much, much faster than computing the inverse of M. Let me just provide a very simple example, very trivial. So suppose that, as I said, we want to solve, let's say, AX equal to B, okay? And suppose that our matrix A has the following form. Okay, here I put some numbers, let's say A11, A22, and here is ANN. Here, suppose that is zero, and suppose that the other numbers are different from zero. Okay, so I have A12, and here I have A1n, and so on and so forth. And here I will have A2n, etc. So, do we really need to compute A minus 1 to solve this problem? Well, of course not. Because if you think a moment, so what happens is that we have to take A and we have to multiply by a column, and the column is x1, x2, xn, and this is equal to b1, b2, bn. So what happens? We can write, of course, explicitly all these equations, just making the matrix product, but we can notice that start from the last equation. So if we start from the last equation, what happens is that we just read ANN XN equal to BN. But this we solve immediately. We solve immediately XN is equal to BN divided by A and N. And after we go back to the one but last equation, so we get something as A, so this would be A N minus 1 N, and here I would get A N minus 1 N minus 1, so the equation would be A n minus 1 n minus 1 x n minus 1 plus A n minus 1 n n x n equal to B n minus 1. But the point, of course, is that this is an n, x n we have just determined. So x n now is known. We go back here and we compute xn minus 1 in the most simple of the ways. So essentially, we just solve all these equations, starting from the last and going back to the first, without absolutely the need of computing the inverse of a matrix A. This procedure, as you can imagine, is much, much faster than computing the inverse of A. So this is just a trivial example of a situation in which you can solve a linear algebra problem without computing the inverse of a matrix. By the way, this little trick is what is at the basis of what is called LU decomposition. This LU decomposition is the idea that you start from a generic matrix A, and after you concentrate once on the upper triangular part, it is called U, and once on the lower triangular part, which is called L, and you know that separately the two problems of solving the equation, let's say LX equal to B or UX equal to B, are very simple. And so this LU technique is based on how you can rewrite essentially the original problem in terms of the two matrices L and U, which after is very, a very simple problem to be solved very rapidly. Okay, by the way, you can find explicitly these techniques discussed in plenty of books, etc. But instead, let me show you in the last 10 minutes or so just how we can start implementing this in Python. So now, if I go over here, now what should I do? I have to switch off this computer. Yeah. Aspetta un attimo, perché voi non lo vedete, no, giustamente non lo vedete. Su questo. Esatto. Okay. Cioè, stacco il tutto, l'attacco lì, buonanotte. Sì. Su questo cosa, su Chrome, ok? E cosa devo... Smetto di presentare, interrompo la presentazione, ok, e lo faccio da là adesso. Okay. E devo staccare il cavo in modo tale che voi possiate vedere. Questo di qua vedete, devo per forza attaccare il cavo del proiettore a quell'altro aggeggio. Si vede qualcosa, questo qui cosa devo fare? Devo stop sharing, immagino, questo qua. Ma forse è più facile se io faccio partire da là quell'aggeggio, buonanotte. State vedendo, e da casa, vedono qualcosa da casa?
Sì,
vedete? Oh, ok, va bene. Scusate, oggi è un pasticcio. Aver lasciato a casa il pennino è stato un disastro. Vabbè. Cominciamo a vedere qualcosa. Ci sta a leggere qualcosa oppure no? Perché io senza occhiali non vedo assolutamente niente. Quindi. Vedete veramente pochi. Sì, certo. Ma se io semplicemente attacco di questo aggeggio non è più semplice. Ok. Ci vedete a leggere questa roba? Va bene. Però devo mettere il microfono di qua probabilmente a questo punto. Ok. Qua. Ok. Speriamo che sia il ritorno. Scusate un attimo. Cos'è che devo ancora pigiare? Ce n'è ancora uno qui. Adesso se lo attaccavo di là era più semplice. Ah, c'è ancora quello. Bravo. Grazie. Ce l'abbiamo fatta, va bene. Scusate, oggi è un disastro. Allora, quindi, tornando qua, Okay. So what I wanted to show you is the following. How do we solve a problem by explicitly using one of the routines existing inside Python that are specialized in the case in which the matrix is a bounded matrix. A bounded matrix is a matrix where you have a limited number of diagonals different from zero above and or below the main diagonal. So we already solved the example 6.8, Open the 6.8. Okay, but the reason is that it was not the system, but it was, okay. Sorry, I had to open this one. This one, okay. Now this should be the one, right one. This was the example 5.19, I think. Yeah. Okay, whatever. So let me close the other things because instead it's complicated. Okay. So we have two codes. This is the code that we discussed together for this example that is still running, I hope. Yeah. So this is the code for solving the 5.19. And here, in this specific code, we have not used the fact that the matrix is tridiagonal. What we did here was just to invoke a generic code for solving a linear problem. Essentially, the problem was at the very end similar to the one that we are discussing, but much simpler because there was not the time dependence. So it was just a problem of the form AX equal to B. Actually, here the matrix was called K matrix, and F was the right hand side. Okay. So I have solved again the same problem. Should be the same problem if I not mess it up. But this time, explicitly using a code, this code here, solve bounded, that is a code that exploits the fact that the matrix is tridiagonal. So let me rapidly discuss, we can come back to this next time, let me rapidly discuss how this code works. So essentially, this solve bounded, I mean, you can find, of course, if you go to this scientific Python, there is some help. Actually, even if you pass on this, you can probably find some help. But there is one point that is very important. The point is, I don't know if you can read very badly, isn't it? You see, there is this, what appear now in gray, I know that is very difficult to read. But the main point is, in order to use that code, the matrix has to be written in a special form. That is a form that is, so to say, optimized in order to pass the information that the matrix is a bounded matrix. Essentially, suppose that you have, as it is our case, a tridiagonal matrix. And so we have a main diagonal and two other diagonals, one above and one below. So essentially, you don't need to write all the matrix. You just want to pass the three diagonals which are different from zero. So you can pass that directly into the code that is after solving the equation. This solve banded, what asks you is how many diagonals different from zero there are above and how many there are below the main diagonal. In our case, there is one above and one below, this one. Point is, after you have to give these numbers, of course, and these numbers have to be written, and see if it appears again. Yeah, I know it's almost impossible to read. Oh gosh, if I could write also, but it's very difficult. Okay, if you look, I don't know if you can know.
Prof.
If you look in this gray area.
Prof. Per me non è un problema in realtà.
I don't know if you can see it. One line which is completely filled. That line is the main diagonal. So what I'm going to do is to rewrite the information that before was stored in an n times n matrix into a matrix that contains, okay, the row have a length of n, but how many rows I have? If I was in a three diagonal problem, I have only three rows. So the main diagonal, of course, has n numbers, because I started with some n times n matrix. So it means that I will have one of the row completely filled with the numbers of the main diagonal. And if I only have one diagonal above and one diagonal below, it means that the other two diagonals contain n minus one and n minus one numbers. This is exactly what is written here. Essentially, you are shifting one of the diagonals, writing it in order that it occupies the n minus one slots to the right, and the other one below the n minus one slots to the left. So essentially, done here. I built this object that is called AB, I think, somewhere. I have to find where. Where is gone? AB is here, and there must be an AB above. Here. Okay, here it is. So how did I build this special matrix? So let me tell again, this matrix has how many columns? N columns, n minus one in our case, but only three rows, okay? And how did I fill it? It's very easy. The main diagonal sits, so to say, at the center of this matrix, and there will be two other rows, one above and one below, and in one of them, the numbers are pushed to the right, and the other are pushed to the left, okay? So is what appears here. In the one, the 0, 1, essentially I push the numbers to the right. Explicitly, I am filling, notice this usual trick here, in range n minus 2, it means 0, 1, 2, n minus 1. Okay, 0, 1, 2, n minus 1. So, and here I am telling, okay, go and fill the first of the rows. The first row is labeled in Python 0. As I know, it's horrible, but it's like that. And I push all the indexes, so to say, to the right. So in this case, just by one step to the right, I plus one. So the first number will be whatever, because after is not even read by the code. And after I have all the n minus two numbers of the upper diagonal. The second is the main diagonal. It occupies the entire row. And after, again, I have n minus two numbers of the lower diagonal. At that point, I have built this matrix with three rows and n minus one columns, and I just pass it to Python, to this numerical code that is called solve-banded. I just have to tell, look, this object is an object that contains corresponds to three diagonal matrix, and there is one diagonal different from zero above the main, and one different from zero below, and one and one. And after this code solves the problem very rapidly, much more rapidly than the other one that was inverting the matrix. Okay. So what I want to do is systematically to use this solve-banded, because of course it is so to say conceptually at least the main reason to make this effort to go to the finite elements and linear polynomials, etc., etc. And okay, let's see. So what we do next time is to try to solve the time dependent problem, but by using this technique, etc. Sorry, today was terrible. I mean, the absence of that little pen caused panic to the guy who is supposed to give his lesson. So I apologize for that. Okay, any questions?
No, it's all okay, I think.
Still alive, people from home?
Yes, yes, we are alive.
Yes.
Secondo me non c'è più nessuno. Sono disconnessi, ma
visto secondo che voi... non si sente.
Teoria sì.
Ci siamo.
Ok. Siete sicuri? Che sent... Anche tu un messaggio, ok, va bene. Ok, va bene, ci vediamo domattina. Scusate ancora per il paciocco oggi, questo pennino mi ha stravolto. Ok, allora devo disconnettermi da tutto, quindi devo disconnettermi a domani, sì. Stop presenting, anche stop recording, e anche sull'altro. Allora, qui però basta che mi scolleghi, cioè chiudo questa finestrella. Okay.